behalf of the Department of Science, I would extend a very cordial welcome to all our three dignitaries for this panel discussion. Thank you so much for all of you to be being present here at the college. So I believe that your presence in the college will definitely ignite the young minds. So once again, a very happy welcome to all of you. It's said that curiosity sparks imagination. It is the spark behind every idea. Things actually which is driven out of pure curiosity brings out a revolution and brings about a revolution in human affairs. It's my pleasure to have such important and important dignitaries in our midst. To begin with, we have Dr. Vilas Shelke, Senior Scientific Officer at Department of Barkatullah University, Department of Physics in Barkatullah University. Then we have Dr. Nirmal from ICER Bhopal, and we have Sayam Srivastav, who's been recently recruited into Indian Revenue Services and also a decade of experience in astrophysics and astronomy. So we welcome you all, sir. Thank you so much. Dr. Vilas, I would like to start with you. Generally, it is said that children are very curious. What happens is we tarnish the curiosity because we stop giving them answers. So how to actually bring about and keep that curiosity alive in children?
To me, human mind is always curious, irrespective of age, whether it is a small child or whether it is a grown-up person. But what happens as we grow up, our priorities change. Initially, for us, for a very small baby, food is the priority. As it grows, then it starts looking the world around around him, and then it becomes curious. What is what? The first thing comes to a child's brain is what is eatable, what is not eatable. So that is where that curiosity starts. Then probably somebody said that by the year we become 5 years old, then we learn whatever is needed to survive in life. After 5 years, what we learn, that is just from our curiosity. And then with the years, the priorities shift to different goals in life. Then we focus on the questions which are only relevant to our personal development or personal growth. But for a better future or for a better life, it is always good to keep asking questions. Now, when we stop asking questions, normally when it happens that somebody starts refusing or starts not listening to your curiosity, then you feel disappointed and then you probably you stop asking questions. But asking is the way to learn new things, not only about science, not only about technology. You can ask anything happening around you. You should be curious why it is happening so.
Right, he said, sir, as Albert Einstein also said, never stop questioning. Actually, questioning should be answered. The problem is we stop answering, we stop responding, and that is why the childlike question dies down. So thank you for answering it so beautifully, how we can keep the curiosity among the students alive. Similarly, sir, you are working in ICER. If I would like to ask you, how do we keep the scientific temper alive in the youth today? How do we bring about the scientific temperament?
So in order to answer this question, I would first like to discuss what scientific temperament that we are talking about. Scientific temperament means if we see something, some phenomenon, we try to analyze it, try to find the actual reason behind why this is happening, and we should not believe in any explanation, any easy explanation of it that is not accurate. Now, keeping scientific temperament alive, it's something not so easy in my opinion. For example, if a little child sees a phenomenon and the child has said that this is the rule of the nature, why this is the rule is not explained, and the person is not asked, not encouraged to ask further questions. So this question is rather related to the previous question, and right from there I would try to address this question. Keeping the scientific temper alive, that only requires the environment. So the elder people around us, if they always encourage us to ask questions, even if they are not able to answer, that is the way to have it alive. For example, when Newton, in the famous story, he saw one apple falling from the tree, and he asked people why that apple fell down. People said that's the rule, because there was nobody to pull it up. That's why it fell down. But that doesn't really satisfy the scientific temper. And Newton at that time, exceptionally I must say, had the right temper to dig deep into it and find an acceptable answer to the society. So one must encourage this kind of questions. These questions, many questions with the correct scientific temperament may sound quite stupid. At that time when Newton asked people why this apple fell down, people thought, oh, what a stupid question it was. But that was not really a stupid question. That was the question to ask at that point of time. So we must allow stupid questions, so-called stupid questions. That's the way we can possibly keep the scientific temper alive.
Yeah, so how many of us are Newtons among us? Actually, we have stopped producing Newtons or stopped becoming Newtons. What is it? That gravitation was discovered long back by Newton. We need many more Newtons to be produced and keep that scientific temperament alive. So Sayam, you are much younger to all of us here. And you can be very proudly called as one of the millennials, if I am not wrong, a very young person. So if I ask you, what about the scientific temperament in the youth? How do you see the paradigm shift in science of today's youth?
Hello, good afternoon everyone. First of all, why do I see all the dull faces over here? Why there's no illumination? Why there's no shine? While I was in the college, while I was sitting over there at your space, I used to be so happy with all the dignitaries, all the experts being over here, giving us some illumined kind of knowledge, something that would render us the best in time to come. Also, concomitantly, I was going through all the quotes over here, all the adages over here. There's a beautiful adage by the great father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi, and that is right there that I can see. A man is but the product of his thoughts, isn't it? What he thinks, he becomes. So many of you right here are thinking, oh, we are getting bored. So that means you have become boring, isn't it? Question yourself. You are here to gather something. You are here to learn something, isn't it? You are here to exchange. You are here to question. So you know, none of us actually want to become boring. None of us actually want to come out of the nutshell and be of no productive use or consumption outside to the society, isn't it? We have a strong government who is actually trying to promote such a scientific temperament. We have all the projects and programs like the Inspire, the Mudra, and so on and so forth. But if we, being the youth of the society, being the youth of India, are not dedicated enough, not zealous enough, we are not having that presumptuously the zeal within us that we want to do something out of the box, that we want to do something that would trigger us, we want to do something that would inspire others, then there's no use being whatsoever the best that you are. You have to just unfold your dimensions, you have to come out with better expertise, you have to come out with a better frame of mind. Along with that, just coming back to the query. By the way, I would like to hear from all of you a good afternoon in retaliation to what I greeted all of you. Please, good afternoon once again.
Good afternoon, sir.
Still not that loud.
Good afternoon, sir.
That's it? You did not have proper lunch? Okay. And the guy right in front of me, are you bored? I can read body language very well. Just be cautious and just be kind of have your ears up. And I would come back to the query of scientific temperament that we were talking about. And it has not been long ago that I was at your place. And it has been not long ago that I got promoted into the government services and at the same time into the scientific world. So you know, science does not take place in the classrooms, first of all. If Newton was sleeping or lying down somewhere within the class, he would have never seen an apple falling down, isn't it? perhaps from the window, but his entire mind would have been hallucinated somewhere on the board, or on the faculties, or on the teachers, isn't it? So you need to better come out. You know, science is something that is better comprehensive when you apply the practicality into it, when you apply the practical part into it. If there's no practicality with the science would be like remotely something very boring to you. I can tell you all the universal law of gravitation, but until and unless I take you out and I show it to you with all the practicality and all the better means which are outside, you won't enjoy it simply. So you know, the scientific temperament, as man has cautioned me, has undergone a paradigm shift in all these years and all these decades, I would say. You know, initially we had a lot to discover. As the time unfolded, as the centuries passed away, the things have reduced. We are having the better resources at our disposal, but we are not having the creative mind. Where are the creative minds? Creative minds are somewhere dormant in uploading the stories on Instagram, isn't it? Somewhere dormant in uploading the stories on Facebook or WhatsApp, isn't it? We need to come out of it. We need to actually rendezvous ourselves into something better. We need to cross caution, get into the self-realization that we are the people who can actually make something better out of the society and something better out of the science. It has been long ago that India has achieved a good Nobel Prize in the field of physics, I would say. So, you know, it is because somewhere our thought process has become stagnated. Initially, the people were not having the social media, but they were having a free time, they were having a liberal time to actually get into all the complexities, to actually come out of all the intricacies, to better know themselves, to better know the nature around them and the cosmos around them. So that was where the actual innovation cropped in. But today, the world that we are living in, we are having too much of it. We are having too much of social media. The internet has developed to be something very good, and we are currently living in the Industrial Revolution 4.0, if you people are aware. So Industrial Revolution 4.0 is something that is better marked by, characterized by the Internet of Things, and apart from that, the artificial intelligence, and the third generation and the fifth generation computer numerical programming, and so on. So, you know, well, even in this revolutionary generation of Internet of Things and artificial intelligence, if we do not caution ourselves, then we are somewhere killing the science within the young minds. And this paradigm shift has been kind of sadistic at the same time, you know, simultaneously along with all the other parameters of resources that we have in. We have came out with so many programs, entrepreneurship program, and so many good innovations by the government. But we are not getting the good innovators and the entrepreneurs to actually enroll in. Why is that? Because people are not having that zeal now. They are more of fondled by the things that they see around. They are more of fondled by the gadgets and not why they work and how they work. So that is something that you need to contemplate upon. You need to come out with a better, I would say, the morphosis and better know yourself, so that this paradigm shift that has occurred in the field of science can be actually narrowed down over time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sayum. Vilas sir, I would like to ask you, has media, social media, hampered the scientific temperament of the youth in some way?
I won't say so. And even if I say so, probably this young generation will not agree with me. So I will not say the same thing. Social media like Facebook, where it has generated, the guy who created this social media, the social media name came later on, but the guy who created Facebook or that wall and posting and all those things. So that was an innovative thought. It wasn't a great discovery. Everything needed for this was already there. Society was there, social thoughts were there, internet was there, everything was there. But only the thinking out of box. His idea was out of box and everybody picked up with that idea. So even many students who are quite engaged with social media, who are all the time they are on internet, or even they can have very creative mind. So it's not that but of course, you need whenever you are on social media or any platform, then also your mind should have some curiosity. It's not just you got a post and forward. So nowadays many WhatsApp group, the admin has the responsibility that forwarded posts are not allowed. So there is a lot of creativity on WhatsApp. But there are some members who keep just forwarding. So that's not good habit. Just somebody has posted something and you are forwarding. There is no creativity. You can bring on your own creativity even in social media activities or even your day-to-day activities, anything which is related, while searching on internet, you can have multiple questions in your mind. And it is very easy because of this internet. Internet of things is that anything that comes up to your mind, you can just Google it and search for the answer. So immediately you will get answer to your curiosity. But of course, you have to be careful. There can be some information which is misleading. So you have to again choose that which is correct information. And while posting also, you have to choose that which is the correct information. But of course, keep doing WhatsApp. Even now also, you can use your WhatsApp and Facebook. No problem with that.
Yeah, that's right. But my question was, and Nirmal sir, if you can answer that, like you're mentoring the millennials. The thing is that we have stopped observing an apple falling down or a guava falling down because we are most of our time we are engaged with Instagram, Facebook and other things. So our observation of the nature has come down drastically. We have stopped observing a rainbow, we have stopped observing many other things. So how do you rekindle that fire in the students? Like most of the time I find students are busy till 2 o'clock in the night playing PUBG. So where is the time for observation? So even if the mind is there, the IQ levels have gone up, but then there is no time for observation. What is the solution for this?
This is, I must say, an excellent question that you have asked, and the world is thinking about this. So if I share my experience at Aizer Bhopal, there are excellent students that we get, the best of the country. But then after coming here, many of them get exposed to very high speed internet, which they didn't use earlier. And then they start playing video games. They get addicted to Facebook and stuff like that. And as a result, some of them keep playing PUBG or similar games, Bluebell, whatever, these kind of games, until 4 o'clock in the morning. They miss lectures in the next morning, and many of them skip breakfast. So in that process, they are damaging their health as well as their career. And being an institute, our job is not to produce Newtons, but to provide the framework from where the Newtons can emerge. In other words, we cannot produce the peaks in the range of mountains. We can just produce the range. And the peaks, they can automatically emerge on their own capability. Not every student of our institute will become a great scientist, but some of them will become because of that environment that we can provide there. Now, fast internet connection is necessary at today's time. Without that you cannot do good research, it's not possible. But at the same time, it's becoming difficult for many of the students to focus on their work. And I must say, we don't have a solution to this problem, because when I studied at IIT Bombay, the solution they found was to stop the internet connection after 12 in the night. If we do that, nowadays there is, since the inception of Jio, there is so high speed mobile internet, you can't do anything about it. You can't stop it. And they can do whatever they like. And the only way that we can possibly do something is to encourage them to play outdoor games instead of locking themselves inside their rooms and be busy with video games and stuff like that. But everybody will possibly acknowledge that video game and these video games, it's not on one computer, that interacts with many people over the network. So this kind of video games is very addictive, and many people have committed suicide. Many young people are no longer with us just because of these video games. I'm not blaming the video game in its entirety, but there are cases of that, so we must take a note of that. So I think the only way to get rid of that addiction is to go for some outdoor games apart from studies, and that keeps you healthy from that keeps you physically healthy as well as mentally healthy. So National Science Day, as we know, it's 28th of February, and that was the day when C.V. Raman and his research group first observed Raman effect. And that was the reason, as Sayam pointed out, that India got one Nobel Prize in physics for that discovery.
Raman effect, what is the importance? Already he mentioned that why Raman effect is important. Just to make it simple for you, it is a simple concept. Anybody could have thought of that concept. We know atoms, everybody know atoms. Atoms has, being a science student, that basic structure probably, everybody knows that atom has a nucleus and there are electrons revolving around it. But while talking with my students, I always say that atoms are just like a human being. They behave like a human being. If I ask all the atoms to assemble in a room, they will not assemble unless I apply the force. So they are just like human beings. The moment they get little bit of liberty, they move here and there. That's the nature of atoms. Similarly, like all of us like to speak. We talk too much in private or in public. We like to speak. The same way we like to listen music. We like to sing a song also. Same thing is true for atoms also. They also like to sing. They also like to listen music. So whatever music is created by atoms, that is somewhere related to Raman effect. Atoms or molecules, in more scientific way, they vibrate around their mean position. When they vibrate around their mean position, that means they generate certain kind of energy, certain kind of waves. And by picking up those waves, we can identify what is the energy of that atom or what is the energy of those molecules. And that is what precisely is Raman effect. Now, since atoms and molecules are part of everything, every object around us, so anything in this universe is made from atoms and molecules. So that means everywhere these atoms are singing, everywhere these atoms are making a noise. So by picking that noise or by recording that voice, we can know that how these atoms and molecules are behaving. And therefore, we can know the properties of materials by knowing the Raman effect. So that is why Raman effect itself has turned an entire branch of science. Many more discoveries after Raman effect, for which Nobel Prize has been awarded, they are on the basis of Raman effect. Raman effect has been used as a tool for discovering new materials, new phenomena, even new technology. And that is why we as an Indian should feel proud that Raman has done such a great job. Even now also, as a material scientist, there are very few papers where Raman effect is not used as a tool. So, and that is why we must feel proud and we must keep celebrating this Science Day for years and years ahead of this. Thank you.
Adding further to whatever the two experts have told you, I would like to zero down back on the query, why the National Science Day? Why do we celebrate this one? Well, you already know about the great Raman, the great scientist from India who held us a Nobel Prize in 1928. I would like to further add the scientific temperament that has been going on in the country of India and also in Southeast Asia. And what other than that, what we are currently having, what can we add up to that? And by National Science Day, how could it aid us? What would be the resources necessary for us to actually get into it? And how can we make the better utilization of this day? Okay, so, well, I would like to again quote an adage, read for the one by the great father of nation, that there is enough for everybody's need, but there's never enough for everybody's greed. So now we have now understood in India that the need is non-negotiable. Okay, we are riding upon a 2.5 trillion GDP of economy, having a great growth of 7.3. In time to come, be about to the greatest economy of the entire Southeast Asia and the world, even riding ahead of the China in time to come. So we have been allotted merely around 0.6 or 0.7% of the GDP as the national budget for science, for the allocation of the research and development. That is a very sorry state of science that we are currently into. The government has recently increased, there has been an increment for the fellowship of science that was until somewhere 23 or 24% in past 4.5 years, despite a demand of 80% hike in the research fellowship. Why is that? Because people like you and me and all of us, we have to make this effort, we have to come forward and we have to actually get into it. We have to come up with more projects, more innovations, and we have to actually come up with more this scientific temperament so that we can actually march forward into this stream. You know, it took us really a great amount and a really great zeal of struggle to come out as an independent country. As sir has already told you, you know, the state of education was really a sorry state in India while we were under the British colonial rule. So during imperialism, almost at around, you know, 1928, we were having so many different commissions for education. One was the Woods Dispatch, the other one was the Hunter Commission. So now all these commissions, they tantamount to somewhere around 1 lakh rupees per annum as the gross whatever they gave, the remittances for the education and for research and development. So now from that time onwards, the state of education has been really a sorry one. And every year that we come again, every year that we march into, we have this National Science Day that we can actually contemplate and dive deeper within that, okay, there's a day that has been exclusively dedicated for the field of science and that we have to actually do something into this particular field so that we can come out with more new inventions, we can come out with a curious mind. And as they say, there's an adage that curiosity is the mother of all invention. So if you want to ever come out with some sort of invention in time to come, any sort of invention, the path-breaking one into the 22nd century, then you need to question right here, you need to question right from this very stage, and you need to become more vigilant regarding whatever is going around in the field of science. You need to cover up all the recent developments and research and whatever has been the recent allocations for the science and everything.
I hope that we don't limit science only to books and examinations and are able to reach out to research, small researchers, and are able to become small scientists in our own way. It is generally said, sir, जो साइंस नहीं ले पाते वो कॉमर्स लेते हैं. But what about the career prospects in science? Do you see a lot of career prospects in science, in the field of science? Please guide our students on this.
Okay. Why do we opt science as a subject? Normally speaking, during our school days, Newton is the first person, our hero, because we hear the stories about Newton. Then probably we think about Einstein, then maybe some that twin brother paradox and something. Sometimes we see Discovery Channel, so that launching of satellite and then astrophysics and those things looks amazing, or even some animals and wildlife thing. So these are the things which really impress us during our school days. And then everybody thinks that, oh, I will learn science, it is so beautiful. By the time you come to 10th standard, then you see that beauty is fading away. It's not that beautiful. There is no Discovery Channel in your textbook. There is no astrophysics even in your textbook. What you study is mathematics, physics. Even if that Newton's laws and those don't inspire you, so it becomes quite of some boring job. Again, by the time you go to 12th standard, then it becomes more and more mathematics, more and more equations, no colorful images, most of the black and white diagrams. So then again you question that, why I am going for science? But at that time, then it is pressure from your parents. No, you have to do science. You are a good student, so you have to do science. Then first, most of the parents, either engineering is one aspect or medical is another. That time even parents don't think for civil services. They just, you are in 12th, so you have, after 10th, either you have to go to a science, you have to take engineering, or you have to go for medical. So that time it is a pressure from parents, or you are influenced or guided by your parents, or sometimes cha-cha, cha-chi, mama, mommy, and they also influence that you should go for science. But again, then you have limited choice where to go after 12. Then it depends on your percentage or your hard work, that which line you go. But let me tell you, of course, you have to do hard work, or you can make a career in any line. Like our panelist, he has done interdisciplinary kind of things, astrophysics also, and like he was telling. So career is another point, but you should make a career in that line which inspires you. If you have an inspiration for science, then go for science. If you don't, if science don't appeal you, then you may go for commerce. You may go for arts also. Nothing bad with that also. Even by doing arts and commerce, you can go for civil services and you can virtually rule the country. Science people may not rule the country, but civil service people or arts people, they can rule the country. So that option is there. But science is something which when it inspires you, you can do a lot good things to the society, to the world, to the humanity. So science has a wider perspective, and therefore out of those wider perspective you have to choose which path you want to follow. Now since I guess you are a BSc student, so definitely after 2 years or after passing out a degree from here, you will be looking for prospects where now we should go. So if you want to continue with science, then probably you will be going for MSc, MSc in India or MS in abroad, or maybe some people will like to go for management or computer degrees. So those are the options available after BSc.
So thank you so much, and thank you so much for coming over and having inspired the audience and for such meaningful discussions. We hope to have the discussions more frequently. It should not be like observing the National Science Day. We would do that on National Science Day, but apart from that, we would try to have it organized more frequently. So thank you all gentlemen for joining us, and thank you students for that patient hearing.